Start in the name of Jesus Christ, and I want to pray in Jesus' name to give all the glory to the Lord. Let me pray in Jesus' name. Mighty Father, Jehovah Jireh, the King of Glory, Holy One of Israel, I give you all the glory and I praise you, for there is none like you, Jehovah. We glorify your holy name and we praise you, Jesus, for you are gracious, you are holy, you deserve to be worshipped, you deserve to be glorified, to be honored in Jesus' name. Thank you because of this day that you have given us, that we may worship you, that we may glorify you, that we may praise you, the Messiah, in Jesus' name. Now, Jehovah, my Redeemer, I pray your presence, I pray your glory, your grace that is sufficient, be with us right now in Jesus' name. Speak to us through your word, speak to us through the gospel in Jesus' name. Open heaven, Jehovah, through your holy name. Lord Jehovah, I come against every evil forces, every powers of darkness, of confusion, of destruction, of resisting the message. I rebuke it in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray your presence, your power, your grace to be with us here in Jesus' name. Speak to us, Jehovah, and reveal yourself by your word. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray and even believe. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. God bless you. Hallelujah. God bless you in Jesus' name. Welcome, welcome all of you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Yes, I want us now to start the word of God, and the Lord will bless us in the name of Jesus Christ. I want to speak about the latter glory and the last days revival. I want to speak about the latter glory and the last days revival. And I want us to turn in our book, in the book of Malachi 1:6-10. That is the word of God that God gave me yesterday. And I was turning to the scripture and I was asking God, oh God, what is that word that you will give to me? Because I do not have any word. I don't have anything to teach your people. But what word will you give to them? What word will you minister to us, to them in my soul? And I turned to the scripture, to the Bible, and when I read, I came to a scripture in the book of Matthew chapter 1 verses 6-10, and that is where the Lord told me that is where the message is coming from, and it is the message of the hour. We don't preach something that is not season. We preach something that is season when we are in the Spirit. Therefore, this is the message of the hour that comes from the book of Malachi 1:6-10. That's where we are reading in the name of Jesus. The Bible says this in the book of Malachi verses 1. Malachi verses 1, we are starting 6. Yes, Malachi verse chapter 1, 6 to 10. Chapter 1, 6 to 10. The Bible says, a son honors his father, and a servant his mother. If then I am the father, where is my honor? And if I am a master, where is my reverence? Says the Lord of hosts, to the priest who despise my name. Yet you say, in what way have we despised your name? Hallelujah. The Lord is saying, a son honors his father, and a servant honors his master. If then I am your father, where is my honor? And he say, and if I am a master, where is my reverence, or where is the fear? Says the Lord of hosts. And he say, that you offer defiled food on my food. You offer defiled food on my altar. But say, in what way have we defiled you? By saying, the table of the Lord is contemptible. And when you offer the bride as a sacrifice, is it not evil? Is it not evil? And he say, and when you offer a ram and a sick, is it not evil? God ask, is it not evil when you offer a lamb, when you offer a bride as a sacrifice, is that not evil? And when you offer the ram and the sick, is it not evil? And he's going to say, offer it then to your governor. Would he be pleased with you? Would he accept you favorably? Says the Lord of hosts. But now entreat God's favor, that he may be gracious to us, where this is being done by your hand. Will he accept you favorable? Says the Lord of hosts. And he say, I'm reading in the book of Malachi chapter 1, verses 6 to 10. Malachi chapter 1, verses 6 to 10. And I continue 10. He say, who is there even among you who would shut the door so that you would not kindle fire on my altar in vain? I have no pleasure in you, says the Lord of hosts, nor will I accept an offering from your hand. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless his word in the mighty name of Jesus. Reading from the Bible, the word of God from the book of Malachi chapter 1, verses 6 to 10. God is saying, and he is speaking to the church, that as a son honors his father, and a servant his master, if then I am a father, where is my honor? God is speaking to the church in this age. God is speaking to the church in this age, asking, where is the fear of God in this generation? Where is the fear of God even in the church? God is asking, as a son honors his father, that if you are a son, you honor your father. And if you are a master, you honor the master or your boss. And God asks, if then I am your father, where is my honor? God is asking, if then he is our dad, he is our father, where is the honor of God? The honor of God in the church, the honor of God in the nation, the honor of God in the ministers, the honor of God in the priest, the honor of God in Christians. Where is that honor? God is asking, where is that honor? For he say, and if I am a master, where is the fear? Where is that fear? Where is the reverence? If God is the master, where is the reverence? That is the message that God is asking to the church. That if God is the master, where is the reverence? Where is the fear of God? And he say, says the Lord of hosts, to you priests who despise my name, yet you say, in what have we despised your name? God is speaking to the church. He is speaking to the priest. He is speaking to all people, to women, to men, that where is the fear of God with men, with women. And he say, why is God angry with the church today? Because he say, verse 7, Malachi 1, verse 7, he say, you offer defiled food on my altar. But you say, in what way have we defiled you by saying, the table of the Lord is contemptible, and when you offer the bride as a sacrifice, is that not evil? See what God is speaking to the church, that they are offering defiled food, defiled sacrifice, defiled worship in the church. And God asks, see that you are offering a defiled worship, a defiled offering before God. And he say, is that not evil? When you offer the lame and the sick, that the church, the worship in the church, the worship in the nation, the worship in the people today, in the Christian today, they are worshiping and they are offering a lame sick worship. They are offering a lame, a bride thing, a sick worship, a sick offering. They are offering something that has no value to God. Holiness that has no value, prayers that has no value, worship that has no value. God is asking, and when you offer the lame and sick, is not that evil? Is that not evil? When you offer a lame, a sick thing in the church, look at this, and he say, offer it to your governor then. Offer it to a governor. Would he be pleased with you? Would he accept you favorable? Says the Lord. But now entreat God favor that he may be gracious to us. Look at that. That God is saying that today people, they are offering a defiled sacrifice. They are offering a defiled worship and holy worship. A worship that does not praise God. Holiness that does not praise God. Go to the churches, you see what they used to offer. That's why God is angry with the churches, and he has shaken the churches into a point that they are crossed. Why? Because they offered a defiled sacrifice. They offer a sacrifice that is not holy. When they went to preach, they preach a gospel that is not holy. They offered a gospel that is sick. A sick gospel. A sick sermon. They offered a bride sermon. A worthless sermon. A worthless worship. When they went there to worship God, saying that they are worshiping, but the worship, when God received that worship, he received that worship as a worship that is sick, a sick worship, a defiled worship, worthless worship, Because it has no holiness. It has no righteousness. It has no fear of God. And because of that reason, God is angry. God is angry because of the church worshiping and giving an offering that is not holy, an offering that is not righteous, an offering that does not please God. God is saying, is that not evil before God? That they have brought a mockery in the house of God, the dressing in the church, the dressing of the praise and worship team that they are using to worship with, the dressing which are defiled. Is that the worship that God is required? God says that when you do that thing, when you offer the lame and the sick, is that not evil? Is it not evil before God? Is that not abomination before God to worship God where you are naked? To worship God where you are defiled? Men of God, pastors, preachers, they are worship, they are preaching, but when they are doing those things, they are not holy. Their heart are still banded with sin, sexual sin, immorality in the church, lust, adultery. But they are worshiping, they are preaching when they are pregnating the worship team. So God is saying they have offered a defiled sacrifice, a defiled praises. They have offered something that is abomination before God. And for that reason, God is saying, would you offer a bride and a sick offering to your governor? Why do you worship God like that? Why do you go and offer to God that when you want to give, you give that which is less, that which is sick and bride? Look at this. It's like saying that I am going to the house of God. I am going to support God. I am going to support the work of God. I am going to offer an offering. But when you go to offer an offering, you look in your sheep and you see that sheep that is wooden, that sheep that is sick, that sheep that is blind and lame. And you go before God and give him as an offering. God say that when you offer the lame and the sick, is that not evil? When you offer a bride sacrifice, a bride offering, a bride which is not healthy, which is not perfect, that is evil before God. That is evil before God. That is mockery. That is the same thing that has happened to the church. That the people, they are doing things not willingly. They are giving gifts when they are not perfect. And when they do, they give it as just like that. That's what God is saying, that the church is offering an offering which is not pure, which is not perfect before God. That when you want to give, you give that thing that is bride, that thing that is sick. When you want to give to the poor, when you want to give to the orphan, if you want to give them the cloth, you look for that cloth that is weak, that cloth that is torn, that cloth that has faded, that cloth that you hate, that shoe that you hate. You give it to the orphan. You give it to the poor. And you see the Bible says that when you give to the poor, you give to the Lord. So how do you give an offering to God, which is bride, which is sick, which has wear out? God is saying that when you offer the lame and the sick, is that not evil? When you offer the bride as a sacrifice, is that not evil? When you do things before God and give that thing which is not perfect, is that not evil? Is that not mockery before God? That is what the church has done today. That is why God, he has become angry of the churches, because the worship they have been presenting before God is not a perfect worship. The sacrifice they have been offering before God is not a perfect sacrifice. It is not a holy sacrifice. It is not accepted sacrifice. God is saying that because of that, he said because of that, therefore, he have rejected their sacrifice. He have rejected their offering. And in 10, he say, who is there even among you who would shut the door so that you would not kindle fire on my altar in vain? Look at that. I have no pressure in you, says the Lord of hosts, nor will I accept an offering from your hand. Is that not what God has done? He say, who is there even among you who would shut door? Who would shut the door of the altars, the door of the churches? And that is what God has done. God is asking, he was asking, who is there among you who would shut the door so that these people would not come under and a kind of fire on the altar, a fire on the altar in vain, worshiping in vain, praising in vain, preaching in vain, coming to the church in vain. So God says, there are 10, who is there even among you who would shut the door so that you would not kind of fire on my altar in vain? I have no pressure in you. God has, he has no pressure in them. They are praises, they are worship, they are modesty, they are dressing, they are preaching, they are sermon. He has no pressure with them. Why? Because they have been offering a defiled worship. They have been offering a defiled, a sick and bride offering, and that is evil before God. Without holiness, an offering without holiness, an offering without perfectness, an offering without righteousness, an offering without the fear of God. God is saying, so that who is there even among you who would shut the door so that you would not kind of fire on my altar in vain? Who is there who will close the church? That is how he asked. And the corona came. Corona came and said, I am here, and the churches were shut. They were shut. Why? Because they did not offer a holy offering before God, a holy sacrifice before God, and God decided to close them, to shut. He is wishing, who is there among you who would come and shut the door and close the door and close the door so that you would not kind of fire on my altar in vain, so that you may not sacrifice, you may not worship, you may not praise God, you may not preach in vain in the church? For he said, I have not pressure in you, says the Lord of hosts, nor will I accept any offering from your hand. Look at that. Nor will I accept any offering from your hand. Why? Because they have become defiled. They have defiled the worship. The worship has been defiled. That is what God is saying. Because the reason he have closed them, the reason he have allowed the churches to be closed, or he allowed the churches to be closed, it is because of the evil that was in the church. They were not offering a holy sacrifice. They were not offering a right in righteousness. They were not singing in righteousness. They were not speaking in truth. Their churches, they have become like synagogue of Satan, where all evil are practiced. Homosexual are practiced. Gayism are practiced. Lesbianism is practiced in their church. You see, adultery, abortion is practiced. Nudity is practiced. Lust in the church. Men go there to look for women. Women go there to the church to look for men. There is a lot of seduction in the church, in the pulpit, the pastors, the worshippers. They are dressing seductive clothes, seducing youth, seducing each other at the pulpit. There is competition. There is war, competition. Who will preach? Who will sing? Who will do? Who will dress? It has come like even a fashion show in the church, fashion show of coming with this clothes. With this growth, they are competing. Women are competing in the church. That is what God is saying. It is so much evil in the church that God is angry because of the church. And that is why he said, who is there even among you who would shut the door so that you would not kind of fire on my altar in vain? Who is there? Where is the governor? Where is the president? Who is there that would command the churches to be closed so that they may not continue to offer the vain offering before God, to offer a sacrifice that is bride, that is sick, that is useless, that is in vain? For God need holiness, God need perfectness, God need righteousness. That's why God is saying, who is there who would cross the church? Who is there who would cross those altars so that they may not continually go to praise, to give a vain offering? Because they bring that which is sick. God is sick of their music. God is sick of their preaching. He is sick of hearing their praises. He is sick of hearing their testimony. He is sick of hearing their singing, their worship, because it is defiled, mixed with abomination. It is mockery before God. That's why God says that now I will not accept any offering from your hand. Until you learn to worship God in truth and in righteousness. Until you learn to worship God in truth and righteousness. Because the church has blasphemed God. It has wasted God. It has blasphemed God. It has ashamed our Lord Jesus Christ. into an extent of saying, who is there among them who would shut those doors, so that they may not continually go to offer an abomination, a vain offering before God, and the churches have been shut. Yes, he allowed it because the church has not been presenting an acceptable offering, a blameless offering, a perfect, a righteous. God is holy. We must worship him in spirit and truth. Why? Because the churches has become corruptive. They have become the hiding place of robbers, the hiding place of sexually immoral people, the hiding place of prostitutes, the hiding place of corruption, the hiding place of people who are homosexual, people who don't fear God. They go to hide in the church. Huh? They go to hide in the church. The politicians, when they kill people, when they rob and they steal, they go to the church. To hide there, and they offer a defiled offering, corrupted money, stealing money, prostitution money before the church. So God is saying, when you offer the lame and the sick, is this not evil? When you offer a bride sacrifice and all the sacrifice, a blemish offering, is that not evil? Is that not mocking God? Until God is saying, go and give it to your governor. Go, is that sheep you are offering? You are offering a bride sheep, a sick sheep. He say, go therefore, go and offer it to your governor. Will he accept it? Your governor will not accept it. Your boss will not accept it. Why? Why do you offer to God? And that is why God is asking from verse 6 that a son honor his father and a servant his mother. If then I am your father, where is my honor? Where is the honor of God in the church? Where is the honor of God in women? Where is the honor of God? Where is the fear of God in the worship? That people worship as if they are worshiping men. There's no fear of God in the worship. Lying, false testimony, false miracles in the church. Immorality, adultery, marriage and remarriage. You are marrying today. Tomorrow you divorce. Then the other day you marry again, and it is the church. You are the deacon, you are the elder, you are the pastor, marrying and remarrying. That is what has been happening in the church. God has not received that perfect offering. Their ceremonies are not holy. They are paganic worship, and the song they sing, it is dances of the world. You see, Dobro ya Yesu. They say Dobro ya Yesu, dances of the world. You see, those things has brought a mockery to the church, until God has said in the book of Malachi, chapter 1 to 10. Chapter 1, verse 10. Who is there even among you who would shut the door so that you do not kind of fire on my altar in vain? I have not pressure in you, says the Lord of hosts. The way they sing, the way they dance, that today there is immoral dances in the church. Today there is twerking in the church. Today they are church, they are singing rock, hip hop in the church, dance hall in the church. When you look the appearance of the church, the appearance of the youth, the appearance of the dances, the worship team, you see it is an appearance of the worldly people. It is as if you are in disco, worshiping like a disco, twinkling in the church. Is that not evil before God? He say, when you offer a sick, when you offer a defiled offering before God, is that not evil? Is that not mocking God? Worshipping like the world, reggae in the church, hip-hop in the church, dancehall in the church, drinking in the church, world dressing in the church, shaking the body in the church, shaking the buttocks, shaking, like the world, like the party, like the disco. The church has become like the disco. Is that not mockery before God? That's why he say that who is there among you who would shut the door so that you do not kind of fire in my altar in vain? I have no pressure in you, says the Lord of hosts, nor will I accept any offering from your hand. That's why he have closed the churches. That's why he is closing them. That's why he closed them. Why? Because there is a lot of evil. He preferred to cross them than the people of God to be lied, than the people of God to be killed.
It has become a slaughtering of his sheep, a slaughtering of the people of God, a slaughtering of the sheep of God. They are being slaughtered each and every day, slaughtered with lying. They are slaughtered, they are deceived, they are seduced. There is raping in the church. There is homosexual in the church, adultery in the church. You see, breaking even of the marriage in the church. So God has prevented for all those evil by shutting them, so that they may begin to turn their face to God. They may begin to repent and to turn their face to God, to seek Him in personal, because in that personal way, so that they may have the fear of God. God has done all those things to avoid deception, to avoid a deception, to avoid His people being deceived. His people has been so much deceived, and He wants to lead His own sheep, because the shepherd, they have become the owners of the sheep. The pastors, they own the sheep. The sheep does not belong to you. The men of God, the sheep that you tend, they don't belong to you. They belong to your master, Jesus. But today, the shepherd, they are owning them. They are fighting for them. They are owning them. They are calling them for them. They have forgotten that the sheep belong to their master. They are slaughtering them. They are taking advantage of them. They are misusing them. Huh? They are deceiving. They are eating among them. They that are fat, they took them and they eat them. They slaughter them. They mistreat in immorality, in sexual sin. The sheep do not belong to any shepherd. The sheep belong to the Master Jesus. They don't belong to any pastor. They belong to the Master Jesus. Between the sheep and the shepherd, who is great? Who is worthy? The sheep are greater than the shepherd, because the sheep will remain, but the Master will come and fire that shepherd. And the sheep will remain. The sheep and the shepherd know that the sheep are important, because the sheep belong to the master. You see, that's why God is saying that we should fear God. We should not take advantage of those that are following, those sheep of Jesus Christ. When you offer for sacrifice, offer a blameless offering before God. That's why God has brought that thing, because He have a plan. He have a plan at the end of shaking the nation. He is shaking now the nation, because He wants to revive the people of God back to righteousness, back to holiness, so that when they will be reopened, or when they will go back to the church, when they will be going back to the messenger, back to the worship, back to His altar, they will go with honor. They will go with righteousness. They will go with holiness. They will go with the fear of God. Hallelujah. Let us read in the book of Haggai. Let us read in the book of Haggai 2:6. Haggai 2:6-8. Haggai, we are reading in the book of Haggai 2. Yes, Haggai 2:6. Haggai 2:6. Yes. 9. You will hear what God is saying. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once more. It is a retrower in bracket. I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all the nation, and they shall come to the desire of all nation. And I will fill the temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. Look at that. He said, the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. God says, for thus says the Lord of hosts, once more I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and the dry, and I will shake all the nations, and they shall come to the desire of all the nations. Look at that. God is saying that God will shake. He will shake the heaven. He will shake the earth. Has God not shaken the earth? Has God not shaken the heaven? Has God not shaken the sea? Has God not shaken the ocean? By the pandemics, by the plagues, by the apocalyptic things that are happening, by things that are happening. There is a plagues that are happening. God have shaken this world. The earth and heaven has been shaken. All nations have been shaken. The nation are crying. The nation are crying. They have been shaken. There have been diseases. There have been pandemic. There have been flood. God has shaken the sea. God has shaken the ocean. He has shaken. For he said, once more I will shake the heaven and earth. Once more I will shake the heaven and earth. I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and the land. And I will shake all nations. And they shall come to the desire of all the nations. You see, they shall come to the desire of all the nations. They shall come to the desire of God. All the nation, the one nation that God will reform. All nation in capital, meaning it is they shall come to the desire of all the nation in the kingdom of God. They shall come into the desire of the kingdom of God. When God will shake the nation, when God will shake the sea, when God will shake the church, as he has shaken the church, as he has shaken the ocean, as he has shaken the heaven and earth, people, the church will come to the desire of God. They will come to the desire of holiness. They will return to the desire of righteousness. They will return to the desire of holiness, to the return. They will desire God again. They will desire holiness. They will desire the kingdom of God. That is what God is saying. Because God was doing all those things until they desire to return to him. Until their desire will return. God shake. He shook us. He shook the whole world, the whole nation, the America, the Japan. With the tsunamis, with the tornadoes, you see, with the hurricane, with the flood, with the earthquake, he have shaken with the sickness, with the pandemic diseases, he have shaken the whole world, so that we may come back to his desire. For he say, I will shake the heaven and earth, I will shake the sea and the ocean, until they come to the desire of God, until they come to the desire of repentance, until they desire to repent, until they desire holiness, until they desire the fear of God, until their desire will return, the desire of worshiping God in truth and spirit, the desire of worshiping God in righteousness, in holiness, the desire of offering God a blameless sacrifice, a blameless, a holy, a perfect sacrifice, offering before God. That is what God is saying. And that says that there shall be a revival. For he says that when he do that, he says, silver and mine and gold is mine, says the Lord. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. Meaning, when they shall be shaken, when they shall be shaken, the glory of God shall be greater. The glory of God shall fill his house. He said, I will fill my temple with the glory, says the Lord of hosts. When they have returned to the desire of holiness, when they have returned to the desire of repentance, when they have returned to the desire of the fear of God, when they have returned to the desire of fearing God, when they return to the holiness, to righteousness, after being shaken, God say, I will fill this house with glory. Hallelujah. I will fill my house with glory. Your house, which is the house. God has not just dwelt in the houses built with stone, with the hand of men. He lives in our body. So he will bring glory. The glory of God shall fill the body of Christ. The body of Christ shall be filled with the glory. When the shaking is done, when the shaking is done, when the sea is shaken, when the ocean is shaken, when the earth is shaken, when the church is shaken, when the marriages are shaken, when the economy is shaken, when the world is shaken, God will fill his people with the desire to repent. And when they repent, they will be restored, and God will fill his temple. He will fill his people with the glory. For he say, that says the Lord of glory, that the house, the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former. There shall be greater glory. The glory of this temple shall be the glory of the latter. He say, the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former. The glory of God of the latter shall be so great. shall be so great and will be greater than the former one, says the Lord. Because when he shake the nation, when he shake our world, when he shake our body with the sickness and with diseases, when he shake us, we shall be shaken. When we are shaken, we go back to God. We go back. We get the desire. Yes, we get the desire to return to God, the desire to repent, the desire to fear God. And that is where the church is. The church has a desire to fear God. The church has a hunger to fear God. I have witnessed in my missions right now. I have witnessed that the people, they have now desire of God. When at their past, you would go to preach, but people would not just listen to you. They would pass you like that. But today, when I preach, they are not passing me. They want to hear. They have been shaken. Now they have the desire of God, glory. Now they have the desire of holiness. Now they have the desire of listening to the word of God, glory. Now they have the desire to worship God in truth and spirit. God has shaken the nation. God has shaken the church for his own glory, so that the people will be restored. They will come back to God. They will repent back. They will walk in righteousness back, because they will come to God in righteousness and holiness, because they have been shaken. I have seen, I have witnessed, I am a witness that the people, they have begun to love the gospel. They have begun to love righteousness. They have begun, their desire of righteousness, their desire of hearing the truth has been restored. They want to hear the truth. There is a revival right now. There is a revival. There is a revival of hungry people, hungry women, hungry men, hungry people who want to hear. They have a desire of the truth. They have a desire to know God. They have a desire to know the thought of God in this hour. They have a desire to repent. They have a desire to worship God in the truth and holiness. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the living God. For God says that therefore, for thus says the Lord of hosts, once more I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and the land, and I will shake all nations, and they shall come to my desire, the desire of all the nations, and I will fill the temple with glory. He will fill the temple with glory. And he say, the silver is mine, the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts, because the glory of God shall come back to the church. The power of God shall return to the church. And the holiness, the righteousness shall return back to the church, because they shall be turned to in the desires of worshiping God in truth and righteousness. Hallelujah. God was shaking the world. God was shaking the world because he was looking for our attention. He was looking for our attention. He was calling for his people. For he says, like a son to the father. A son hears the fathers. So when the fathers speak, a son hears. So when God was shaking the world, when God was shaking the nation, when God was shaking the church, he was shaking the church to look for our attention, the attention of his people. He saw that we are not hearing, we are ignoring him. So he shook the earth with distress, with the pandemic, with earthquake, with the flood. He shook the earth. He shook the sea, even the land. He shook them so that we may be alerted. He wanted to seek for our attention to hear what our Heavenly Father is saying. Hallelujah. God was seeking our attention, the attention of every tribe, the attention of every nation, the attention of everyone. He was seeking their attention to go back to his counsel, the attention to go back to his righteousness, the attention to go back to his righteousness, to go back to the truth. Hallelujah. And when they that had God, when they repent, they shall come to be restored, and the glory of God shall fill them. The glory of God shall fill them because they have repented. He will fill the house of God with glory. His people shall see the glory of God. There shall be a great visitation in the church for those who hearken to the voice of God. For those who repent, they will be restored. The glory of God shall be restored to them. For those who return to the desire of holiness, holiness, to the desire of truth, to the desire of fearing God, they shall be filled with the power. They shall be filled with the glory. They shall be filled with the grace. God power shall fall upon them. Hallelujah. They shall see the glory of the Lord. That's why he say, arise, arise, for the glory of God has come upon you. They shall walk in darkness, but you shall walk in the light, for you have hidden. You have hidden to the voice of God. You have repented. You will be restored. The glory of God shall come back to you. Hallelujah. The church shall once more thirst for God. The church shall once more thirst for God. That's why shaken. They have been shaken. They have been shaken. They have been shaken to be restored. They are thirst. To be restored. They are thirst. Their thirst has been restored. The thirst of worshiping God, the thirst, the need to worship God. They will not go to the church to worship in vain. They will go back to the church. When they will go back to the church, they will go back to worship God in truth and spirit, because they have been shaken. And the desire of holiness, the desire of thirsting, the desire of the need of the word of God, the desire of holiness, the desire of worshiping God in truth and spirit, will be restored to the church. They shall hunger for God. They shall be hungry for God. They are now becoming hungry for God. They are now becoming thirsty for God. They shall encounter the visitation, because they have the desire for God now. The desire to fear God. The desire to worship God. The desire to enter the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. That is what God is saying. For he say that the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace to the Lord of hosts. When the shaking is complete, the glory of God shall be manifested in the church. The revival shall be manifested in the church. The latter glory shall be so great than the former glory. The revival of the last days shall be at its peak. People will begin to repent. They will begin to receive Jesus. They will begin to change. They will begin to turn to Jesus in the truth and righteousness. Hallelujah. God says in the book of Jeremiah, look at this. What happens when the nations repent? What's happened when the nations repent? Look at this. Remember what happened. Remember what happened in the days of Nineveh. In the days of Nineveh. When Jonah was sent into Nineveh. Remember what happened when he was sent there. We see that they did not have the desire of God. But when God shook them, when God had shaken the Nineveh, he shook them by the prophecy that he is coming to destroy Nineveh. And when they were shaken, their ears were shaken, their heart was shaken, the king was shaken by the gravity of the prophecy, by the gravity of the message. When they had been shaken, they repented. The desire of repentance was restored to them. The desire to turn to God was restored. And they began repenting. They began repenting. And there was a great revival of sackcloth. The king dressed themselves with the sackcloth. They were dressed with the sackcloth. Even the animal, they were dressed with the sackcloth. They were wailing, they were repenting, no eating, no drinking. The whole nation of Nineveh, there was a great revival. Revival of repentance, revival of holiness. The desire of God was restored in Nineveh because they were shaken. As also, when we are shaken, the desire of repentance, the desire of holiness, the desire of worshiping in spirit and truth will be returned to the church. And large number will start repenting. They start confessing. They return to God in truth and righteousness. When we repent, we become restored. God fills us with his glory again. Look at that in the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 15:19. Let us read in the book of Jeremiah 15. Jeremiah 15. Jeremiah 15. I am reading in the book of Jeremiah 15. Jeremiah 15, that is where I'm reading, Jeremiah 15:19. 15:19, the Bible says this. 15:19, the Bible says this. I am reading, the Bible says this. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, then I will bring you back. You shall stand before me. If you take out the precious from the vine, you shall be as my mouth. Let them return to you, but you must not return to them. I will make you to these people a fortified bronze wall. And they will fight against you, but they shall not prevail against you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you from the hand of the wicked, and I will redeem you from the grip of the trap of the terrible. Hallelujah. He said, if you return, God said, if you return, he's telling people, if you return, then I will bring you back. You shall stand before me. Hallelujah. That if we return back, if we repent, if the church repent, if the nation repent, God said, I will bring you back. I will bring you back to power. I will bring you back to revival. I will bring you back to holiness. I will bring you back to the glory. I will bring you back to the power of the Almighty God. God will fill them with his glory. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the living God. That is the secret of the repentance. That is the secret of returning to God. That when God has shaken us, let us take heed and repent. And when we shall return to God, God say, I will bring you back. He will bring us back. He will bring the churches back. He will bring the minister back. He will bring the prophets back. He will bring the end-time apostles back. He will bring the marriages back. He will bring the children back. He will bring righteousness back. He will bring the holiness back. He will bring the fear of God back to the nation, back to the politician, back to the leaders. He will bring holiness back to the church, back to the family, back to the school. Hallelujah. When we return to God after the shaking, when you return to God, God will bring, he will restore his glory to us. He will restore his blessing to us. For he say that if my people repent, I will restore them. If you repent and turn to me, I will repay you what was wasted by the locust. What was wasted by the grasshopper, I will restore you. The anointing will be restored. What you have lost will be restored. The business will be restored. The ministry will be restored. The church will be restored. Hallelujah. The glory of the church shall be restored. The revival shall be restored. Because when we repent and turn away from sin, God is faithful to restore his people, to call back his people to righteousness. He is a faithful God. He is a faithful God that when we stand again in his way, he is able to use us again. He is ready to use us again. He is ready. Oh God, thank you, Jesus. For God is doing something in this hour. God is returning his people. He is returning the glory of the church. He is returning the glory of women. He is returning the glory of men. He is returning the glory of marriage. He is returning the glory of the nation. After the shaking, when they repent, when they turn to God, when they get back the desire to worship God in the truth, in the righteousness, they will get back desire to worship God. Hallelujah. There will be no minister in the church. There will be no pornography in the church. There will be no homosexual in the church. There will be no strandering, rise. There will be no adultery. There will be no abortion in the church. God will restore righteousness. He will restore holiness. When God has shaken them, he has shaken them to bring back the desire of the fear of God in the church. And therefore, they will have desire of the fear in God. There shall be no more lying, no more false prophecies, no more false prophet in the church. There shall be no more lies, no more jokes, no more entertainment, no more business in the church. No more, for God will restore the church. God will restore his people. They that were in darkness, they will be restored, and they shall see the glory of God, says the living God. For God is coming to do supernatural thing that he did in the days of Nineveh, when he turned and when he shook, when he had shaken the Nineveh, and the desire of repentance, when they returned, God blessed them. God favored them. God glory was upon them, and there was a great visitation. There shall be a great visitation in the church starting from now. That is what God is saying. Starting from now, that because God has shaken the nation, God has shaken the church, God has shaken the marriage, they that understood why God was shaking, they that turned to God, they will be restored. What you had lost will be restored. The grace of God shall be restored to you. Therefore, let us glorify the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for what God is coming to do in the church. After repentance, restoration will come back. After repentance, holiness will be restored. After repentance, fear of God will be restored. Hallelujah. Fear of God will be restored. Look at that. Let us see. You see, many people, they don't know the secret of repentance. They don't know the secret of fearing God. They don't know the secret of repentance. There is a secret behind repentance. People hate to hear the word repent. But those that are in hell, they wish that they could hear that word repent once more. That they would be free. They would repent and be saved and be blessed out of hell. Those that are in hell, they know the blessing of repentance. They wish if they can hear somebody coming to them and telling them, repent and you'll be saved. They would repent. But people in the world, they don't know. They ignore the word repent. When we repent, there is restoration. The second of repentance. Repentance bring healing. Repentance bring salvation. Repentance bring forgiveness. Repentance bring the light. Where there is darkness, repentance bring the light. Repentance bring revival. Repentance bring the blessing and the glory of God. Repentance will be brought back to the church. Repentance will be brought back to the church in righteousness, in holiness. Repentance shall be brought back to the church. When we repent, there shall be a time of refreshment. Hallelujah. Let us read. And you will hear why the apostles were preaching repentance. Why they were preaching repentance. Why they were telling people about repentance. Why they were not hiding sin. They were not hiding sin. They were preaching the truth. Why? They had known that the secret behind repentance. That repentance that you don't want to hear. That repentance, that holiness, that righteousness that you don't want to hear. That is your medicine. That is your solution. That is the only way to be healed, to be restored, to turn back to God. That is the only way for the true prosperity of God to come to you. Repentance is the key. When we repent, He restores. He said that when you repent and return to God, I will restore you the year that has been long wasted by the grasshopper, by the locust. So the secret of repentance, there is blessing. There is prosperity. There is restoration. There is healing. There is glory. There is grace. There is visitation. There is power of God which shall be turned back to the church. Hallelujah, my dear brother, my sister. We need to repent of our sin so that the time of refreshment may come upon us. The time of restoration may come upon the church, the nation, the marriages. Hallelujah. Look at this. Let us hear. Let us see this. The secret. You will see the secret why the apostles, they were preaching the gospel of repentance. They knew the secret in the book of Acts. Acts 3:19. The Bible says, repent therefore and be converted that your sin may be blotted out, so that the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that He may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before. Hallelujah. Whom heaven must receive until the time of restoration of all things, which God has spoken by mouth of all His holy prophet since the world began. Hallelujah. God is saying that in the book of Acts 3:19, that repent therefore and be converted, that your sin may be blotted out, so that the time of refreshing may come from the presence of God. Hallelujah. People preach about the time of refreshment. People preach about the time of restoration. They preach about the time of prosperity. They preach blessing. But God is saying that the true blessing, they are coming from repenting. For He says, repent therefore and be converted, that your sin may be blotted out of that book. Repent therefore, and He say that your sin may be blotted out, and He say and be converted, and so that the time of refreshing may come from the presence of the Almighty God. When you turn to God, the time of refreshment will come, and that time is coming to the church. That moment, that time is coming. The time of refreshment. Refreshment of glory. Refreshment of power. Refreshment of the strength. Refreshment. Restoration of the church. The rata glory. The rata glory of God. The time of refreshment with the rata glory shall be restored back to the church. Back to the ministers. Back to the prophets. Back to the apostles. Back to the evangelists. Back to the pastors, teachers. The power of God shall be restored back to the worship team. It shall be restored. Hallelujah. Repentance bring refreshment. It bring refreshment. It brings the worship of truth and spirit. Because they shall come to be refreshed by the glory of God, by the power of God. Hallelujah. My dear brother, my sister, the time has come for the power of God to be restored to the church. You need to be ready. You need to be ready for that power. You need to be ready for that power. The power of God is coming. They that have repented, they that have turned to God, they that have been turned to God and they have been converted in righteousness, converted in truth and spirit. Their sin has been blotted out. God is saying the time of refreshment is coming. It is coming right in your life. Your destiny shall be refreshed. Your marriage shall be refreshed. Your children shall be refreshed. What you are doing shall be refreshed. Your joy shall be refreshed. Your peace shall be refreshed. Your anointing shall be refreshed. There shall be a fresh anointing in the church. Hallelujah. There shall be a fresh anointing that comes from the repenters. People who used to rack, they will not rack. People who used to cry, they will not cry. People who used to live in shame, they shall live in glory. They shall live in glory because the refreshment is coming. The refreshment of repentance. The refreshment is coming to the church. You are living in shame. You will not live in shame after repentance. After your name has been written in the book of life, God will begin to give you everything that is good. Every delicious, everything that is good, you will enjoy. For he say that you will eat the goodness of the land. Those that fear God, they will eat the goodness of the land. The goodness of the land. They will eat and drink. They will worship God in spirit and truth. The true anointing will come upon them. The power of Holy Spirit will walk with them. The visitation of God will walk with them. Hallelujah. They will be crowned with the anointing of God. Anointing that takes away the shame. For God's sake, he say that if you seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness and its holiness, all other things I will give unto you. Look at the secret. That if only you seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, therefore all other things I will give to you. I will restore you. I will refresh you. Why has the church hated the message of repentance? Why has ministers not preached the message of repentance? Why have they hated to tell people to turn to God? When that is the only solution for the decayed church. That is the only solution for the dead church. The solution for the dead church is repentance. When you want your marriage to be restored, you need to repent. When you want your everything to be refreshed, your life to be refreshed, turn back to God and stop sin. Turn back to God. Cry for forgiveness. And you shall be restored. Repentance bring life in a dead church. When they turn to God, as God says, that repent therefore and be converted, that your sin may be blotted out, so that the time of refreshment may come from the presence of the mighty God. That when the church repent, when they stop wearing miniskirt, when they stop wearing the things of the world, when they stop worshiping like the world, when they stop sin, when they get away from the desires of the flesh, the desires of the body, when they stop pleasing men and start pleasing God, God will bring a refreshment in the church. He will restore them, their blessing, their glory, their anointing. He will restore them. They that were dead, they shall be given life. The church that was oozing in decaying, that church shall begin to blossom, to blossom. It shall begin to blossom with glory. They shall begin to rise with glory. The power of God shall come upon them. The glory of God shall return to them. They shall begin to shine with the light. They that were unseen, they shall become unseen. They that were not recognized, they will become recognized. Hallelujah. The power of repentance. The latter glory is being brought by repentance. The last day's revival is being brought by repentance. It's not being brought by just miracles. It is brought by repentance. When people turn to God, that is the greatest revival. That is the greatest miracle. The greatest miracle is not when the realm are walking. The greatest miracle is not when the bride are seeing. When the greatest miracle is not when the deaf are hearing. The greatest miracle, it is when people are repenting and turning back to God. God says that when one soul turns to God, there is jubilation. There is jubilation in heaven. It does not say that when one walk, when he was bride, when he see, there is a jubilation in heaven. It don't say when one, when there is a miracle here in the world, when people begin being blessed, when they begin having money, it doesn't say that heaven, that the angels rejoice in heaven over that man who have been blessed. The angels rejoice when people repent. The angels rejoice. The heaven rejoice. God rejoice. Jesus wipe his tears. He wipe his tear when people repent. When one soul turn to God. When you see prostitute, slave queen, they are turning to God, and they are turning to God in truth and righteousness. When people turn to God, when they stop sin, when they throw away the pornography, when they throw away the makeup, the immoral clothes, the miniskirt, when they throw away the deception, the false prophets, when they throw away, when they turn back to those things, to worldliness, heaven rejoices. Angels rejoices when one turn to God, because the latter glory will be brought by repentance. And when one so repent, they will be refreshed. They shall be restored by God with his glory, because they have repented their sin. Hallelujah. Oh, I wish that the church, oh, I wish that the nation may know the power of repentance. The power of repentance. Oh, I wish that you would know the power of repentance. That repentance will bring rain. Repentance will bring rain. Will bring holiness. The land that was desert, if they only repent and turn to the living true God who created the heaven and earth, that land will be turned back to green. That land will be turned back and will become a land of flowing with milk and honey. We hear of the desert of Saudi Arabia. We hear of desert, Akali desert. We hear of Sahara desert. We hear somewhere the people are dying of famine, that their land has become desert. We know that there is only one thing that can refresh back their land. Only one thing that can rejuvenate their land. Only one thing that can bring life into a dead land. Only one thing that can bring life to those land, to those nations. Repentance. Repentance will bring rain. Repentance will bring healing. Repentance will bring food. Will bring water. Repentance will bring back life in those nations. Repentance will bring back fertility of the land. Repentance will bring back fertility of the church. Fertility of the nation. Repentance is the key in this hour. For in the repentance, there is the refreshment of God that come back to the church. Hallelujah. Repentance is the key. The key of restoration. The key of the latter glory comes in repentance. Praise the name of the living God. God is saying to us that there is a glory, the latter glory that was promised. It will come back to the church. But it will come back to the church in repentance. In turning to righteousness. Because repentance brings blessing. Look at this. The Bible says, blessed are they that are forgiven their sin. Why are they blessed? Because they are forgiven their sin. God does not count their sin. Though they are they that are blessed. And he also say that about that young man who was the lost, the prodigal son who had lost. When he had lost And when he went to enjoy the world, the pressures, when he asked the father for the share of his inheritance, he went and misused the inheritance by prostituting, by the pressures of the world, by the worldly things. And when he misused his inheritance with women, with alcohol, with the world, with the pressures of the world, he became so poor because he had forsaken his God. He had forsaken his father, and he became a servant, eating with the pig, drinking with the pig, sleeping with the pig. And he came to his sense when he was shaken with that poverty. His desire to go back to his father returned, and he said that in my father's house they are servants and they don't live like I am living. I will go back to my father's house. Because when I go back, I know that I will not be treated like even the servants. But here I am. I am eating with the pigs. I sleep with the pig. I eat the food with the pigs. I eat. I drink here. I settle there with them. I have no peace. Cold. No sleeping. No bed. No house. He has become like one of the pig. So when he returned back to his father, the Bible says that there was a great party that was started in that house. His father slaughtered the fat bulls, and he announced a celebration over the lost son, and they celebrated over the lost son. He was dressed with robe. Expensive robe with a new dressing. He was blessed. Why? Because he returned. That is the secret of returning back to our father. When we return back to our father, we will not have shame again. We will not suffer again. People suffer because they don't know their father. Why are you suffering like the prodigal son, eating and drinking with the pigs, sleeping in the house of the pigs, without peace, without the night, without sleeping, without bed, without shelter, wandering here and there, eating the sewage, sleeping outside like the pig? Why? Because you have forsaken your father's way. Return back like the prodigal son, and the father, our God, will celebrate over you. He will celebrate over you. He will slaughter bulls and the sheep on account of you. You will be now, you will be dressed within the robe of a priesthood, with a robe, with expensive. You will be robed again. You will be adorned with his glory. People suffer because they don't know their father. It is like a child of a president, a child of a president. But that child sleeps there at the street. He is a homeless man. He wanders there to there. But his father is the king of the nation. When you realize your father is the king, when you go back to him, you will not suffer. You will be given what you need. You will eat and drink. Let us return back to our father in heaven. Stop suffering when you know your father is the king of kings. Stop wasting yourself in the pressures of the world. Return back to your father in heaven. He is the king of kings. He will provide you. He will give you everything. He will refresh you. Repent and be refreshed by God. For he says that, repent therefore and be converted, that your sin may be blotted out, so that the time of refreshing may come back from the presence of the mighty God. Hallelujah. Whom heaven must receive until the time of restoration of all things. Return, repent, repent back to God, and he will be restored. He will refresh you with the glory, with the power, with the grace, with the strength. Hallelujah. There is a refreshment. Once we repent, once we go back to righteousness, when we go back to holiness, that's why God is saying that God has shaken us. He has shaken the nation so that they may find the desire to worship God. And when they find the desire to worship God, the glory of God shall be greater. The latter glory shall be greater than the former one. And his glory shall fill the temple, shall fill the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Yeah, they shall not need to be shown. Oh, these are the people of God. These are the people of God. The glory of God shall be seen among them. Praise the name of the living God. The glory of God shall be seen among them, says the Lord God Almighty. Look at this. When the refreshment, when we repent, when the refreshment will be done, the Malachi 3:18 shall be fulfilled. Malachi 3:18 shall be fulfilled. He's saying in the book of Malachi 3:18, the Bible saying, then he said this. This is what he said. He said, then you shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. Hallelujah. You say that you shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked. That is the kind of the revival that is coming. That is the kind of revival that is sprouting. That is the kind of the revival that is coming out of repentance. That is the kind of the revival that will come when the latter glory come, when the power of God will be refreshed in the church, when the glory of God shall be restored in the church. Then you shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked one. You will again discern between the church that is worshiping God and the church that is not worshiping God. You will again discern between a holy filled man of God and a man that is not filled again. Oh, by Holy Spirit. You will again discern. You will be again distinguished. You will again differentiate between a woman of God and a woman not of God. You will be again differentiate between the children of God and the children of the devil. You will see again between one who serves God and one who does not serve God. You will know them by their speaking, by their deeds, by their fruits. You will know them by their dressing. You will know them by their worship. You will know them by the way they do things. You will know them, because that is the latter glory. The latter glory will bring a different. Hallelujah. The latter glory will bring a different. It will bring a discernment. It will bring a distinction between those that fear God and those that does not fear God. That is the work of the glory of God. Hallelujah. That's why God has shaken the nation, has shaken the sea, has shaken the everything. Everyone has been shaken. The economic, the work has been shaken. The marriage has been shaken. Even the children who go to school, the university, they have been shaken. Everyone has been shaken. So that the desire of God, the desire to return to God will return. The desire of the fear of God will return. The desire to repent will return. And when they return to God, the glory of God shall fill them. They shall be restored. They shall be refreshed by God. And when they shall be refreshed, then you shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. Because they will offer an offering which is holy, which is righteous, which is gracious before God. They will offer a holy sacrifice. They will offer their body as a living sacrifice. They will worship God in spirit and truth. They will offer God a blemish sacrifice. They will offer God a perfect sacrifice, a righteous sacrifice, a worthy, holy, in the fear of God. And that is when you will again see the between one who serves God and one who does not serve God. The revival of last days will not be invisible. It shall be visible to all people. They shall see the glory of God back to the church. Hallelujah. You see, when people are shaken, they go back to God. They repent. And when you read in the book of Malachi 3, starting 16, Malachi 3:16, the Bible says, then those who feared the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord reasoned and heard them. So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord and who meditate on his name. They shall be mine, said the Lord of hosts, on that day that I make them my jewel, and I will spare them as a man spare his own son who serve him. Hallelujah. That then those who fear the Lord spoke together, When they be shaken, when there is a shaking, then those who fear the Lord, when they come together, those who fear the Lord, when they spoke to one another, and they become to an agreement, and the Lord listened to them and heard them, and so a book of remembrance was written before them, for those who fear the Lord and who meditate on his name. A book of remembrance was written, and God heard them. So God brought back his revival, that he restored them, that he cleansed them. Hallelujah. That is what God is saying. And that is what is happening. And after the revival, after the shaking, after the church is shaken, you will begin to see the true church. You will begin to see the true men of God. You will begin to see the true children of God. Hallelujah. The worship shall be seen. The identity shall change. The appearance shall change. Their sermon shall change. Their singing shall change. Their dressing shall change. Hallelujah. Look at that. And that is what says in the book of Malachi 1:11. In the book of Malachi 1:11, you will see the revival will go back to Gentile. The revival will go back to Gentile because they have repented, because they have learned about God. In the book of Malachi 1:11, Malachi 1:11, you will see this glory, this rata glory that was spoken. Malachi 1:11, the Bible says, "For from the rising of the sun, even its going down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles." Look at that. "For from the rising of the sun, even to its going down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles." Among the Gentiles, among you and me, among the nations. That's away from Israel, away from the nation that were called Gentiles. People who had not known God. They were pagan. They worship other gods. He said, "From the rising of the sun, even to its going down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. In every place, incense shall be offered into my name." You see, in every places, incense shall be offered for my name. Meaning they shall pray in the name of God in Australia, in UAE, in Saudi Arabia, in India, in Africa, in Europe, in Australia, in America, in Japan, in Asia, in Europe, everywhere. He say, in every place, the incense shall be offered to my name. There shall be remnant. There shall be people who will be found worshiping God in those places. Hallelujah. "For my name shall be great among the nation, says the Lord of hosts." Thereof he say, he continued to say like this, "But you profane it in that you say, the table of the Lord is defiled, and its food is contemptible. You also say, 'Oh, what awareness, and what you snare it.'" And says, and you bring back, 14, you see 14, you say, "But cursed be the deceiver who has in the frock of a maid, and takes a vow, and sacrifice to the Lord what is blemish. For I am great king, says the Lord of hosts, and my name is to be feared among all the nation." Hallelujah. That's what God is saying. For he continued to say, "And a pure 11, for he say 11, "For from the rising of the sun, even its going down, my name shall be great among the nation, among the Gentiles. In every place, the incense shall be offered to my name. And a pure offering," that's where, "a pure offering, for my name shall be great among the nations, says the Lord." And a pure offering, meaning that there shall be a revival in the Gentiles. The revival, they shall offer a pure offering, a pure sermon, a pure worship, a pure praises, a pure dances, a pure holy, a pure songs before God. Hallelujah. They shall offer that pure holiness. They shall offer it from the rising of the sun, because the glory of God shall turn back to the church. Hallelujah. That's what God is saying. There shall be a revival, and that is the revival that was spoken. Pure offering shall be done in the church. People shall begin worshiping God in truth and spirit. Men of God, they will begin to fear God. They will not hide people. They will speak the truth. After the shaking, after this thing, after this situation, you will see pure offering in the church. You will see pure holiness. You will see people who does not joke with God. They fear God. They worship him in fear. Yes, he said, "For my name shall be great among the nation." In every place, Incense shall be offered to my name and a pure offering, says the Lord God Almighty. That is the glory of God that God is saying that shall come to the church of God in the end times. In the book of Haggai, he has spoken to us. The Lord has spoken to us what will come back to the church. That is what was spoken by the prophets. That is what was prophesied about the glory of God, which will return back to the churches in those days, because the glory of God shall return back to the church. For he say that I will shake the heaven and the earth, I will shake the ocean and the sea, and I will bring back my glory. I will bring back my glory. I will shake the heaven and earth, and they will return to the desire of all the nations. They will return to the desire of the kingdom of God, one nation. They will return to the desire of holiness. And then I will fill this temple with the glory. I will fill my people. The body of Christ shall be filled with the glory. And he say that therefore, the glory of the latter glory shall be greater than the former glory, says the Lord. That my people shall worship God once again in truth and the spirit. And that will be the revival that prepares for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. That will be the latter glory that does not joke with the sin. That will be the latter glory that does not hide the sin. The latter glory that will prepare people for the kingdom of God. The latter glory that does not joke with the world. The latter glory and the latter grace that separate people from the worldliness, that change people and transform people to be servants unto the men and the women of God, says the Lord God Almighty. The revival is on the way. The revival is on the way. The latter glory has come. The revival is on the way. The last day is the revival. Prepare for that revival. The revival that comes from repenters. The revival is on the way. The revival that comes from the repenters. The revival is on the way. My dear brother and my sister, that revival is on the way. The revival of righteousness, the revival of holiness, the revival of the fear of God is on the way. Therefore, prepare the church of God. Prepare for the revival. Prepare for righteousness. Prepare to be used by God. Prepare to be sent by God. Prepare for where there was limitation, the limitation will be no more there. God will break the limitation over your life. Where there was boundaries, God will break them. He will bring restoration. He will bring refreshment. He will bring freedom. He will bring his glory unto you. Prepare to be used by God in this great visitation. For God has shaken the churches, has shaken the nation, the sea and the ocean, so that our desire of revival, our desire of righteousness will come back to the church. The time of restoration is coming back to the church. The time of restoration is coming back to the church. The time of refreshment. And when you will be refreshed, when you will be restored, you will become a restorer of others. When you will be refreshed, you will become a refresher of others. Wherever you go, you will refresh others. Wherever you go, you will restore others. When God has refreshed you, you will refresh other people. You will refresh other people. You will restore other people. When God has restored you, and we shall become restorers. Restorers of the ruins was. Restorers of the ruined marriages. Ruined relationship. Ruined church. Ruined life of people. We shall become restorer and the refreshers of people. Hallelujah. That's when the Bible says that you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. You will become the light of the world, giving people the grace, giving people the right, showing people the way, lifting they that have fallen, restoring they that have fallen, refreshing they that are weak by the grace of God, by the gospel, by your life. By whatever God has given you, you will become a restorer and a refresher of they that are weak. Hallelujah. The revival is coming of the restorers, the revival of the refresheners. You shall be used as refresheners. When you repent, you shall be used to turn other people to repentance. When you repent, when you are in that kind of a sin, you will be used to remove people from that sin. If you used to be a slave queen, you will be used to remove people from slave queen. If you used to be a false prophet, you will be used to remove people from falsehood. Wherever you are, you will receive the grace to help people that if you are there, they can also come out. Hallelujah. We shall become the refreshers. If we will be refreshed, you will refresh other people who are in there. If you will be restored, you will restore other people. Hallelujah.
And amen, 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 amen. Let's clap for Jesus. Let's clap for Jesus. Let's give him all the glory. Let's praise him all the glory. Thank you, Jesus. All the glory unto you. We praise you. We worship you. We magnify your name. Prepare for that revival. The revival of holiness and righteousness. Jesus Christ is coming. The kingdom of God is near. May they that have ears, may they hear what the God is speaking to the church in this hour. For he say that the message to the church is that the time has come. For you have been shaken and you shall be restored. You have been shaken and you will be restored back to your glory. You have been shaken. You will have repented. You will be refreshed. You will be restored back to the destiny, back to the image of Christ, back to the proper will of God in the name of Jesus Christ. Let me pray in the name of Jesus Christ for the glory of the Lord. Let me pray. Mighty Father, Jehovah Jireh, the King of glory, the Lord of lords, we worship you, we honor your holy name, and we praise you, for there is none like you. All the glory we give unto you, all the praises we give unto you in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your message. Thank you for revelation of this end time that you have given unto us. Thank you for you have revealed to us about the latter glory and the last days revival. Thank you, Jesus, for making us to understand that the secret and the hidden secret, O Lord, of the glory of the latter days, O God, comes from the repenters, come from turning to you, the gracious one, the glorious one. Lord Jehovah, help the church to turn to you. Help the church to turn to you. Return their desire to serve God in truth and spirit. Return their desire to fear God in Jesus' name. Jehovah God, restore the nation. Restore the church. Restore women. Restore men. Restore the youth in the name of Jesus. Wherever you are, I declare restoration upon you. Restoration of power. Restoration of gift. Restoration of destiny. Restoration of marriage. Restoration of business. Restoration of your marriage. Restoration of your children. I declare restoration wherever you are in the name of Jesus. The repenters bring restoration. The time of refreshment. Oh Jehovah, you have spoken that when we repent and when we are converted, you have spoken that you bring the refreshment. I declare refreshment upon this man. I declare refreshment upon this daughter, upon this son. I declare refreshment, oh God, upon this marriage. I declare refreshment upon these people in the name of Jesus. Restore them and refresh them in Jesus' name. They that were weak, I declare refreshment. Weak in prayer, weak in life, weak in righteousness, weak in the fear of the Lord. I declare refreshment in Jesus' name. Receive in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, let your people receive the refreshment back in the name of Jesus Christ. I declare refreshment. Receive. Receive in the name of Jesus Christ. I do pray and believe. Mighty Father, cleanse the church. Sweep the church. Sweep the body of Christ. Cleanse them. Sweep them. Sweep every evil things. Every evil thing. Every defiled offering. Sweep them. Teach them to offer you a holy offering. A blemish offering. A perfect offering. In the name of Jesus. Sweep every darkness in the church. In the marriage. Sweep. Sweep all ordinance. Sweep all sin. All alcoholism. Drunkenness. Prostitution. Sweep all kind of immorality. Perversion. Sweep all sexual sin. Sweep, oh God, nudity in the church. Sweep by this glory. Sweep in Jesus' name and bring restoration, refreshment in the name of Jesus. That the church will once be seen between those that are serving God and those that are not serving God. That they shall begin to differentiate between darkness and light. That they shall begin to discern between the wicked and the righteous one. That they shall see the glory of God walking among your people in the name of Jesus Christ.
We thank you, Jehovah God. We praise you, Jehovah, for revealing to us such great secrets of the end time. All the glory be to you in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Master. Thank you, Redeemer. Thank you, Jesus. All the glory unto you. In Jesus' name, we pray that you may remember each and every of us, even as you come and return again. Remember us, Jehovah. Lord, sanctify us through the truth of your word. In Jesus' name, O God, we do pray and we believe. Amen.
Get the end-time writings of Apostle Simon Gishinga, a humble end-time messenger with an apostolic wisdom of the Word of God and end-times revelations, preparing the bride of Christ for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ in complete holiness and righteousness. Go to Play Store, Android application and search Apostle Simon Gishinga. Click and download the application. All messages are offline once you download them. Receive back the ancient word of God, reviving the saints for the kingdom of God by inspired living word of God. Search Apostle Simon Gishinga on Play Store application.